Good morning, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Welcome to the USAID ASSIST Project Capstone webinar. We're so glad to have you all with us. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us this morning or at whatever time of day where you are. My name is Lisa Maniscalco. I'm with USAID's Office of Health Systems, and I serve as the agreement officer's representative for the USAID ASSIST project. Again, welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us today. First, I'd like to thank our colleagues at the ASSIST project for their efforts in putting together today's exciting event. So in particular, the project director, Rashad Massoud, the director of knowledge management, Lonnie Marquez, and special assistant, Kelsey Piva. And I'd like to give a special thanks to all of our presenters, commentators, and discussants, especially our colleagues joining from the Ministry of Health Uganda, Ministry of Health Antigua and Barbuda, the All India Institute of Medical Science, WHO, and the USAID mission in Uganda. I'd also like to take a moment to recognize my USAID colleagues who I've worked with very closely over the last several years, and they have served very ably as technical advisors and activity managers for the ASSIST project. This includes Rhea Bright, Senior Quality Improvement Advisor with the Office of Health Systems, and colleagues with the Global Health Zika team, Eric Berenick and Ariana Serino. The USAID ASSIST project was awarded in 2012 and at the time was building off of more than 20 years of USAID support to healthcare quality improvement. This support included taking the collaborative improvement model, which was originally developed for use in industrialized countries, and applying it in USAID-assisted resource-constrained countries and settings. This model emphasizes peer-to-peer learning and local adaptation of interventions, and has contributed to large-scale spread of evidence-based care models in many USAID-supported countries. The USAID ASSIST program was designed to further the capacity of host country health systems to improve the effectiveness, efficiency, patient-centeredness, safety, accessibility, and equity of the services they provide, with particular emphasis on scale-up, institutionalization, sustainability, documentation of methods, and evaluation and cost-effectiveness studies in order to generate new knowledge and advance the state-of-the-art in the implementation of modern quality improvement methodologies in resource-constrained settings. USAID ASSIST's key activities, achievements, and lessons learned will be highlighted throughout the webinar today. I hope you enjoy the presentations and discussions and take the opportunity to submit your comments or questions via the Zoom chat function so you can contribute to today's rich dialogue. Thank you again for joining us. We're so happy to have you with us. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Rashad Massoud, the project director for USAID ASSIST. And he's the Chief Medical and Quality Officer and Senior Vice President of the Quality and Performance Institute at URC. So Rashad, handing it over to you.
Thank you, Lisa. I also would like to welcome you all to our event today. It is wonderful to have so many colleagues and friends join us to celebrate the accomplishments of the ASSIST project. I also want to wish you all well and that you are keeping safe in this pandemic. I will be your MC for the meeting. We have a great agenda for the next 2 hours that includes presentations, commentator, remarks, discussions, and we have enough time for questions and discussion from all of you. But first, I will take a few minutes to give you an overview of the key learning and achievements from the ASSIST project. Next. The USAID Applying Science to Strengthen and Improve Systems project is a 5-year cooperative agreement implemented by URC with several wonderful partners whom you can see here. Originally awarded as a 5-year agreement, which was due to end in September 2017, it was given a costed extension for 2 years to deal with the Zika outbreak. And this year we received a no-cost extension through June to finish up that important work. The goal of ASSIST is to build the capacity of host country systems to improve quality of care along all the dimensions of quality of care, to support the programmatic implementation of the improvement strategies, and to generate new knowledge that increases the efficiency and effectiveness of applying improvement science in low and middle income countries. As you can see, these goals are consistent and contribute to the Millennium Development Goals, which we were dealing with when this first started, the Sustainable Development Goals, and universal health coverage today. And also importantly, contributes in a significant way to the journey to self-reliance. Next, please. Over the life of the project, we have served 46 countries around the world. The countries that we have served are those that are colored in different colors, and the different colors denote the different technical areas that we have worked in each of these countries. You will note that some of them have more than one color, they're striped, and that indicates that we have worked on more than one global health priority in that area. Altogether, we have probably tackled all of the global health priorities for the US government working in this arena. Next, please. I'd like to say a few words about what underlies everything that we do on this project. And what underlies it is this basic idea that if we continue to do what we're doing, we will continue to get the results we're getting. If we want better results, we have to do something different, which basically means we have to change what we're doing and how we're doing it in ways that allow us to achieve the better results. As we do so, we work with teams of frontline health workers. We work with them hand in hand to test different changes to the way, to what they're doing and how they're doing it. And we look at the results, which basically means we have to have data on an ongoing basis to be able to tell. And based on the results, we take action, whether to institute, ramp up, discard, modify, and the rest. And this basic idea underlies everything that we do. Next, please. I would like to give a high-level summary of some of the key accomplishments. As you can imagine, working for 7.5 years in 46 countries across all the global health priorities, there's so many results. And I'm trying to summarize them in a nutshell here. But we'll hear more about these in the discussions that follow. One of the key things that we have accomplished is to support developing the capacity of countries to improve quality of care. And in that respect, we have developed national quality strategies and policies in multiple countries. We've worked with the countries to operationalize them. We have a number of products and reports that document these experiences. Next, please. In tackling some of the global health priorities like maternal, neonatal, child health, family planning, reproductive health. We've done so at scale, and some of the results are on the slide here, and they do include results like reducing maternal, newborn, childhood mortality and morbidity, and doing so at scale. They include improving the cost effectiveness and the efficiency of care delivery. And importantly, they also include addressing the equity gap as we do so. We've had a large effect in the global technical leadership arena, contributing to many global efforts around the world related to maternal and child health. Next, please. In the HIV/AIDS arena, we have really supported increased linkages, retention, and adherence to treatment, care, and support in multiple countries. For example, in the Partnership for HIV-Free Survival, which you'll hear more about later on, in Uganda, we were able to reduce maternal to child, mother to child transmission from 17.2 to 1.5%. We pioneered standards for processes and for quality of care in the arena of orphans and vulnerable children, and supported national male circumcision programs in several countries. We have a publication as a special supplement on the results of the Partnership for HIV-Free Survival, and we were instrumental in developing the VMC-CQI external quality assessment toolkit. Next, please. Many of the results that I just described are quantitatively produced, and they're primarily shown as time series charts, indicator over time frequently collected data. And they're done at the site level and then aggregated to district and national levels as appropriate. But importantly, they address multiple areas. So for example, you can see here in Uganda, in the northern region, addressing the 1990-90 strategy. In the LAC Zika arena, compliance with evidence-based standards. And importantly, like the one from India on neonatal health, reductions in case fatality and mortality. Next, please. In the arena of health workforce development, we've mapped task shifting experiences for PEPFAR. We've institutionalized HIV training packages for nine universities in Nicaragua. And in Cambodia, we did a very interesting piece of work, which is to develop the regulatory framework for the health professions in the country. Next, please. Throughout our work, we've integrated gender into our activities. We've basically done that in across the board in the global health priorities in multiple countries. We have collected sex disaggregated data throughout and worked with this sex disaggregated data to address the gender disparities through developing specific interventions to target one or the other. I do want to thank our partner YHER for their enormous work in this arena. We have multiple products, including a guide to integrated gender improvement. We have an global health e-learning course and multiple briefs covering multiple technical areas. Next, please. We have provided global technical leadership in the area of quality improvement on behalf of USAID. Many activities in this arena that include convening a Salzburg Global Seminar on learning about improvement, how do we learn about complex adaptive systems, and publishing a supplement of the ISPA journal dedicated to the work and the achievements of this seminar. We have published 66 articles in peer-reviewed journals. We've given 234 presentations at major conferences, developed 10 national healthcare improvement policies and strategies in 10 countries. You will hear about the Book of Case Studies, which is a major product that has been developed. And we have online trainings in improvement in English, French, and Spanish. And we also have a global health e-learning course on improving healthcare. Next, please. In the area of managing knowledge, we have captured the everyday learning that happens across all of the teams that we have worked with across all of the countries. We have applied these methods and techniques to our learning sessions. We have developed multiple change packages, knowledge handovers, and others. We have in excess of 200 different knowledge products that include case studies and how-to guides, packages, and different others. Next, please. Of course, with all the knowledge gathering, there remain many unanswered questions in research and evaluation. And for those, we have deliberately designed studies to understand and to document all of these different questions. We've conducted in excess of 50 studies in 32 countries that have included validation of indicators, use of comparison sites, economic analyses, improving effectiveness of improvement, how to make improvement better. An interesting study over multiple years was conducted on accreditation in Indonesia. We have published a guide to rigorous research designs, evaluating complex health interventions. We have in excess of 30 reports, research reports, 20 of which and 20 peer-reviewed publications. Next, please. In doing this work, we have learned a lot about how to strengthen health systems, all the way from the frontline level ability to implement evidence-based practices in everyday life. We've also learned that the role of leadership in sustaining this work going forward, and in this respect, we have developed 13 sustainability and transition plans with different countries. We have seen the effect of these methods at the district health management systems as well as the national levels. We've learned the power of multi-country portfolios such as the VMMC portfolio, the Partnership for HIV-Free Survival, and the importance of working at the community level with improvement methods, such as the work we have done in the areas of maternal and child health, in orphans and vulnerable children, and the HIV/AIDS work in Botswana. You will hear a lot more about these lessons and others in the learning topics today. Next, please. Before we go to the questions, I have a delightful surprise to share with you all. With us today is Jim Hybe. Jim, if I may call on you, please.
Good morning, Rashad. Great to be with you. I didn't write this slide, so I don't claim to be any kind of hero. But I,
Jim, if I may, over the past four decades, you have designed and overseen seven global mechanisms, two PRI-CORES, three QAPs, HCI, and the ASSIST project, all of which built one on the other to improve quality of care and to evolve the science of improvement in low and middle income countries. Jim, you must be proud.
Well, I am proud of the work that has been done under your leadership, Rashad, and I do think that it's a piece of work that has been genuinely new. It's innovative, and it is it shows every sign of being permanent, a permanent improvement in international health, and I think that is something that you and your team should be proud of.
Thank you. Jim, as you reflect on this legacy, can you share with us what are the accomplishments that you are most proud of?
Well, I do think that at the very beginning, we struggled with introducing what was a fundamentally new concept. At the time, the idea of doing something to improve healthcare had only one answer, and that answer was training. And it was virtually universal. This is what donors supported. This is what technical assistance organizations did. They did training, and then you were on your own. You were trained, and you were expected to do better. And I think that what I would think would be the lasting legacy of the ASSIST project would be focusing directly on what healthcare workers do, on the details of the process of care. And that was really new. And so I think that you were challenged in that effort by taking on a new challenge, something that there was no body of experience to draw on, no experienced experts in the field. You really had to invent that field as you went along. And so I think that's what I'm most proud of. I think you started with nothing, a field that did not exist, and you very quickly developed a vibrant and I think lasting change in healthcare programs around the world. I think that we've now reached the point where no one can ignore, no health managers could ignore the quality of care that's being provided in their program. And I think 20 years ago, they wouldn't even know what you were talking about when you talked about quality. Now it's a universal responsibility of managers that's fully accepted and part of everyone's view of healthcare. And I think that's an enormous accomplishment.
Jim, if I can ask you another question, where do you see the field of improvement going from here? What do you see next?
Yeah, I would think that making improvement really a routine activity in every healthcare system presents us with the challenge of establishing and maintaining the quality of those improvement works, that it's done well, that it's done in a responsible way, and that it's produces results that we can be proud of. And that all implies not just careful planning, but careful evaluation. And I would think that evaluation of quality improvement will be one of the areas where we'll be giving much more emphasis in the coming years. I think we'll be trying to fine tune the principles that have been pioneered by the QI project.
Jim, thank you so much. I know that I speak on behalf of thousands of colleagues, but I thank you for your leadership and for your nurturing. It's been a real pleasure. Thank you.
It's a great opportunity. I'm really grateful to have been in the right place at the right time to work with such an outstanding group of individuals and under your leadership. And I think carrying out a really revolutionary improvement in international health.
Thank you. What I'd like to do now is to open it up for questions and comments. Please type in your questions in the chat box. What we will do is we will take the questions as they come. If we come up against time, what I will do is after the session, we will respond to those questions in writing and post them together with the recording of this webinar. So we have a few minutes. Please, Jorge, thank you for the clapping. I appreciate it. Please ask any questions, any comments that you have. Okay, I am not seeing any questions at this stage, and that's fine. At this point, what I'd like to do is to first learning topic is how quality improvement strengthens health systems, improves service delivery, and supports progress toward country self-reliance. Our presenter is Nigel Livesley, and our commentator is Jackie Callanan from USAID in Uganda. Nigel, Jackie, please.
Great. Thanks, Bashad. Sorry about that, everybody, and thanks for sorting that out, Kelsey. Next slide, please. So poor quality of care is now leading to more deaths than poor access to care. So while health facilities health systems have done a pretty good job of fixing access issues, when people do access services, the care that they get there isn't really as good as it should be. And while the consequences of poor quality of care come out of the system at the level of the provider and the patient and are felt by the patient, the causes of poor quality of care exist all over throughout the system. They're more complex. Some of them do exist at the level of the provider, but more often they happen at the level of the team or the unit or the facility or higher up at the district or the national level. And the causes of poor quality care are also very variable. They're not standard. They vary from district to district, to facility, and even within a facility from unit to unit or shift to shift. Next slide, please. And so despite this complexity and variability, as Jim was saying, you know, most approaches to improve quality of care really revolve around training or supervision. Next slide, please. And these methods aren't particularly effective. And that sort of makes sense. You know, training and supervision are efforts to change individual provider behavior. They don't address the other causes of poor quality of care. And part of what ASSIST has been mandated to do is to try and change this, to help people see that there are other approaches that you can use and to help systems build the capacity to use those. Next slide, please. And so we focused a lot on improving people's ability to use quality improvement approaches because they solve different types of problems and because they are effective. Next slide, please. And so strong health systems can't just rely on training and supervision. Those are not going to be enough to deliver good quality of care. You have to have a wider variety of approaches that solve different types of problems. Quality improvement should be one of these because they do solve problems that training and supervision can't. They solve teamwork issues, they solve process issues, and they solve issues between different parts of the systems. But they're quite different. You know, facilities can't just decide to use quality improvement methods on their own. They require a support from the whole system. They require institutional mechanisms that focus on building teamwork skills and focus on building the skills related to quality improvement. And that's quite new. And that's the other part of ASSIST, helping governments put in place these institutional mechanisms. So I'm now going to hand over to Jackie Callanan from USAID in Uganda, who's going to talk about how Uganda has approached this and tried to build institutional mechanisms through the government to support wide-scale quality improvement use. Jackie, over to you.
So thank you, Nigel. I'll give the next slide. Yes, so I'll give a brief summary of our experience in Uganda. So as shown on this slide, quality improvement in Uganda has evolved over time from pilots in a few facilities into full-scale initiatives led by the government. We are institutionalizing QI approaches as routine care in key health areas such as HIV, TB, maternal and child health, as well as implementing QI to address systems challenges or performance gaps, specifically in HRH and the supply chain. So the goal of our investments, particularly with the ASSIST project, was to promote sustainability and transition beyond the lifetime of the project to ensure that the successful interventions were institutionalized and productive on an ongoing basis. The next slide. So in close collaboration with the Ministry of Health, we built the capacity of QI implementation across all levels of the health system, as shown on this slide, which is instrumental in supporting and realizing widely agreed upon and shared goals. The critical success factor is the senior leadership support and the adaptive learning culture committed to data-driven quality improvement. In addition, Uganda's decentralized model of health service delivery encouraged a bottom-up approach where the district leaders were empowered to implement and invest in QI activities. All right, so our approach is over 1,000 health facilities. So we're using rapid testing cycles complemented by a collaborative approach to facilitate spread. We also utilize the platform to support implementation of national guidelines, rapidly scale up effective interventions, address system or structural barriers, and promote client-centered services across all levels of the health system. So a harmonized approach to QI has enabled us to maximize the use and sharing of results and data to continuously inform and implement QI practices. So we have seen promising results from the National QI Initiative, which are informing national policy, guidelines, and standard operating procedures. These results from the initiative, there's a slide that we'll share which shows the results that we've had from the management of HIV virologic non-suppressed clients. And what we've seen that within a year, we achieved a statistically significant shift across three process indicators. And I have identified a change package through learning sessions and harvest meetings. And these are being taken to scale to improve systems and client level barriers to treatment. So that was the next slide. Okay. So this is the results that we have from our initiative to improve the management of HIV virologic non-suppressed clients. So the next slide. So similarly, we've seen the same performance trend in TB preventive treatment completion rates. And again, change packages have been identified for spread. So in summary, government leadership and commitment, capacity building across all levels of the health system, collaboration between stakeholders, and harmonization of QI approaches are important factors to facilitate institutionalization of QI. And most importantly, self-reliance of the host country government to address quality gaps across its health system. Thank you.
Thank you, Nigel. Thank you, Jackie. We have a couple of minutes left, and what I'd like to do is to ask if there are any questions to Nigel or to Jackie. Please, if you have any questions, if you would type them in the chat box and we will take them, or comments. I'll just take a moment to say that we will have the PowerPoint of the presentation along with the recording available after the session, and you can certainly see it on the ASSIST website. So I have a question that reads, I do understand that USAID projects like ASSIST aims at building the local capacity of host countries to continue with the interventions from the project subsequently ended, when the project subsequently end. For ASSIST projects, how would you gauge the host country's uptake and ability to continue the work after closure? The question comes from Emmanuel. Jackie or Nigel, if you would like to take this question, how would we gauge the host country's uptake and ability to continue after the ASSIST project has left?
I think I'll take that one. So the ASSIST project actually ended for us about over 6 months, 8 months ago. No, that was just the closeout, but it was more about a year ago. And what we've seen is that the government, because of the capacity that we have built, government has been able to lead and coordinate and design QI initiatives on their own with very little support from us as USAID or other partners. They have also developed and revised the national framework and strategy and framework on their own, drafting it as a ministry. And we can see that the Minister of Health herself has been part of launching guidelines and policies that have been developed by the Quality Assurance Department in Uganda. So having the government have the capability to create an enabling environment to oversee and to coordinate and to have all the initiatives carried out at different levels of the health system and across all, more than 1,000 health facilities, to me, I think is something where we can gauge that the government and post-assist has the capacity to uptake and continue the work that we have done. Thank you.
Jackie, thank you very much. I do see other questions in the chat box. However, we are up against time, and in order to maintain the schedule, what I will do is answer these questions after the session and post them on the website. In the meantime, I want to thank Nigel and Jackie for a wonderful presentation. I would like to introduce our next learning topic, and it is building individual and institutional capacity in improvement. Our presenter is Tamar Shiteshvili, and our commentator is Professor Ashok Diarari from the All India Institute for Medical Sciences. Tamar, Ashok, wonderful to have you here. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Rashad. Good morning, good afternoon, everyone, and sorry to what's happening in this Zoom meeting. You see how situation can be rapidly changed and requiring quick adaptation and problem solving. Next slide, Kelsey. And this is exactly the key essence of our approach to build knowledge and skills. ASSIST has supported hundreds and thousands of care providers, local organizations, and quality improvement teams to diagnose and fix the problems through their own solutions. This included to work in multidisciplinary team and prioritize all the problems, use different tools to diagnose the problem and identify and prioritize solution, and then monitor the progress over time and adjust actions based on the routine monitoring results. It's very important to say that these skills can be applied to any team problem solving beyond specific clinical area and even beyond health interventions. Next, please. Next slide. As Nigel mentioned, building only the skills in quality improvement is not enough. We need to also strengthen systems to support quality improvement. And what we mean in that is to build a host government's national, subnational capacity to set up and operate quality improvement supporting systems at all levels, support coaching, which is a regular hands-on on-site support to QLP implement teams. And this is important because care providers did not learn how to do quality improvement during the pre-service or in-service education. And lastly, how to monitor the progress over time at facility above site level and use the data for continuous learning and adaptation. For all these components, we have developed multiple tools and resources that are available. And this includes, for example, development of real-time improvement indicator database, which currently tracks the progress of over 1,000 indicators, has over 500,000 data points, and allows to track the progress and compare the results within health facility, across health facilities, regions, and across countries. Next slide, please. The quality improvement capacity strengthening taught us that quality improvement capacity is built through simple, practical, step-by-step guidance and tools, engaging frontline providers in learning by doing, and engaging local mentors and local organizations to do so. Also, routine monitoring of quality improvement efforts using time series charts has been shown to be very effective tool to build skills in data analysis, interpretation, and appears to be a key driver of change and data use. To promote sustainability, accountability, shorten the feedback loops between levels, and accelerate the pace of change, it is essential to embed quality improvement capacity in existing systems, which may include incorporation of quality improvement in pre, in service, and continuous professional development, incorporation of it in on-site quality support into existing district and subnational structures, and overall incorporate quality improvement in overall policy and strategy agenda. Lastly, we have learned that virtual platforms such as ECHO, telementoring, virtual learning, or e-training courses are effective and efficient tools to build quality improvement and clinical capacity. ASSIST has developed multiple plethora of tools, as Rashad mentioned, in all these components and content areas. So there are guides, quality monitoring tools that has been used beyond ASSIST project in many different countries and can be further disseminated and scaled up. Thank you. Let me now ask Professor Dorari to give us one specific example how the quality improvement capacity has been built in India. Thank you, Dr. Dorari.
Thank you. Thank you, Rashad and Tamar, for giving me the opportunity of sharing how at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, we have been able to build the capacity for doing quality improvement across various disciplines. And in addition to that, we have been able to get this into many of the national programs of Government of India, that quality improvement is a part and parcel of the training and the workshops which happen. As Jim said, training alone or workshop alone will make no change. So we have made it a part and parcel of the training and workshops which Government of India undertakes. Here is the photographs of my team leaders at All India Institute of Medical Sciences. They are young champions of quality improvement. They have been teaching this across disciplines in their department. Aparna Sharma from obstetrics, Akshay Kumar from emergency department, Dr. Anu in neonatology, Parijat Chandra in ophthalmology, And then we have nursing leaders, Dolma and Meena Joshi. They have been able to convert the young resident doctors, the nurses who are working in various departments at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, teaching them the simplified approach of quality improvement for process improvement in their disciplines. Next slide. With the help of USAID ASSIST, especially Nigel and Rajesh Mehta from WHO CRO, we were able to create a simplified four-step approach of quality improvement for improving maternal and newborn health in the labor and delivery room. This is a very simplified approach which we were able to ingrain into all the training and the workshops which the obstetricians and the neonatologists were doing. And then at the end of the training, we used to teach them quality improvement methodology and teach all the participants what are the things they are going to do once they go back, how they will do it, and when they will do it, so that their mind used to get converted into that quality improvement has to be a part for making an improvement in the care which they will provide in the labor and delivery room. Next slide. Next slide. In the initial years while we started, which was like 5 years ago, we found the greatest challenge was all the bureaucrats and the health professionals used to think that quality improvement is equivalent to quality assurance. They never used to talk about quality improvement, but they believed if we have a structure and SOPs and guideline, that is what is quality of healthcare, and quality improvement was not there in their mind. So we were able to convert in the bureaucracy, in the leadership, in the institution, in the leadership, in the professional organization, like Federation of Obstetrics and Gynecology, Indian Academy of Pediatrics, National Neonatal Forum of India, and even the local CEOs, the head of the departments in medical college, try to explain to them that quality improvement is much different as compared to quality assurance. And it is one part of a health system approach which we have to take, in which quality improvement is the most important thing, and it is in the hands of the frontline workers. At AIIMS New Delhi, we were able to convince our leadership that each one of the new resident doctor who joins in our institution and the nurse who joins, they have to be exposed to the quality improvement science learning. We were able to do each year clinical grand rounds for all our faculty members in the institution so that quality improvement becomes part and parcel in their division and the departments. Many of the dissertation and thesis which were done by the medical doctors were on quality improvement methodology, how this is going to be applied in various disciplines. We were able to create medical college networks for improving maternal delivery room care, which is a huge big program by Government of India, which is called as the Lakshya program for labor and delivery room. And then we were able to create a network of medical colleges for improving best practices for the care of preterm babies. We taught quality improvement methodology along with teaching best practices for the care of preterm babies. Next slide. Next slide. So as you can see, we were able to take and disseminate quality improvement methodology while we were teaching preterm package in the entire country in multiple institutions by creating the team. And then we were able to monitor what quality improvement work they are doing. And they were able to document that. Many of that resulted in publications which were shared in the public domain. Next slide. And at this point, I would say this would have not been possible because in the year 2015, for the first time, we met Nigel, who was working in USAID ASSIST. And then with his help, we were able to get coaching done through Institute of Health Improvement, Cambridge, at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, to a network of medical colleges in the country so that we are able to disseminate quality improvement methodology in many centers, which are the leading centers in the country. We came out with the help of USAID ASSIST, a complete publication, which had 20 stories on quality improvement in the Journal of Indian Pediatrics. In addition, we were able to create an app, which was a virtual learning platform on quality improvement on POKI, which is point of care quality improvement, which initially was meant for mother and newborn babies in the labor and delivery room, but we were able to scale it up across disciplines in emergency department, in the eye department, in the medicine department, in the surgery department, and it resulted in multiple publications which are in public domain at this point of time. Thank you.
Thank you, Tamar. Thank you, Ashok. Let me, it is 10 o'clock, but I'm going to take one question. The question is, how often the concept of quality management is instituted in the planning part of programs and services? Tamar or Ashok, maybe one of you would like to respond to this.
Yeah, so Rashad, as we moved along, we realized it is not only quality assurance and quality improvement which we need to, which makes a health system run. We also realize it is so important that we must have a data collection system which has to be there in hospitals, in institutions, and someone who can look at the data and make a analysis of the data. And then we need finances and resources to support and make sure the supply chain is also maintained if we are talking how a health system is going to run. We started with quality improvement and then piggyback it to quality assurance, thinking that these are two sides of the same coin and we will be able to run health systems on that. But it looks to me that health system is much broader and it needs multiple pieces to run at this point of time. And we are trying to convince government and even many of the program managers that if you have to run a health system, it is multiple pieces which you need. It is not only quality assurance and quality improvement, which are though the pillars of running a health system.
Thank you very much. With this, if I may thank both Tamar and Ashok for a wonderful session. And I would like to move to our next learning topic, which is organizing and institutionalizing structures and processes to sustain high quality health systems. Our presenter is Victor Boguslavsky, and our commentator is Dr. Henry Mabwesa from the Ministry of Health of Uganda. Victor, Henry, welcome. Let me pass it on to you.
Thank you, Rashad. Hello, everyone. It's wonderful to be with you today and to see you on screens. Next slide, Kelsey. Yes. Yes. So the high quality system requires institutionalized structures and processes of care, effective leadership and governance to support quality improvement and engagement of health and non-health sector actors to promote and sustain quality improvement at scale. And a key aspect of the institutionalized QI is to demonstrate the application of the methods to clinical and other service areas for which no direct technical assistance was received. Next slide. The rest characteristics that define institutionalized QI, and they go along with the four key set of areas, such as the leadership and governance that focuses on a culture of improvement and building a supportive environment, considering larger health system functions, support with resources needed to implement improvements, and holding staff accountable for improving the quality of care. That also sort of utilizes approaches to improvement that you use more as an organization's ability to continuously improve rather than just individual sort of improvement activities. It engages staff to improvement to work and emphasizes the use of data to improve decision making. Transparent communication and teamwork is absolutely essential, as it facilitates clarity about the improvement priorities and aims and progresses made and challenges faced. Creates communication between the leadership and facilities, and teams and across the teams. And last but not least, it requires professional development, human resources, which are characterized by the availability of the assigned personnel to improvement activities and teams, as well as ongoing staff support with training, coaching, data collection, and review. The next slide. It was mentioned already that various countries are at different stages of moving towards QI institutionalization. ASSIST particularly supported 17 countries, and 10 countries have been supported with strategies. But at this slide, I really wanted to highlight Uganda's sort of remarkable achievement over the past 20 years. And it sort of like echoes Nigel's point about the system support and Jackie's remarks about the building quality sort of institutions and capacities in Uganda. You will see at this slide that it has created quality support structures at the national, regional, and district levels, supported establishment of quality improvement teams at the facility and community levels, and connecting the facility and communities, which is very important. It's established reporting on quality of data, developed and implemented tools for quality assessments and quality monitoring, including the annual health facility quality assessment programs. It's organized staff training in quality improvement and coaching, and importantly, actually, communication of quality improvement and about quality improvement across the country. Those are very strong ingredients of building the structures and processes for improvement. So next slide, please. Dr. Henry Mbeza is the Director of Health General of Health Services at the Ministry of Health of Uganda, who has been a long colleague with ASSIST and its predecessors projects, and has seen the evolution of the quality improvement in Uganda for the past over probably 20 years. So what we did is we posted a few bulleted points, which Dr. Mbeza will cover in his remarks. So over to you, Henry. You hope you're still with us there.
Thank you very much, Victor, and thank you very much, Rashad. Good morning and good afternoon, colleagues and friends. Like Victor has said, I'll be running through these pillars, just making a commentary about each of these pillars, each of these remarks and statements. I'll first discuss the issue, and I'll be looking at them from the perspective of the policy level. And I'll be looking at the key pillars that have led to sustainable development of the quality improvement efforts in this country. I think one of the biggest pillars that have strengthened our quality improvement efforts is the fact that there is top leadership commitment to embrace quality improvement as a whole system approach, not just as a disease-specific intervention. We also have a fully fledged quality assurance department, which has been in place since 1994. So for us, it is a whole system approach, not that the department is looking at one or two interventions. It just cuts across all departments. Like Victor said, we have already established structures through the quality improvement framework. We have so far run two quality improvement frameworks and strategic plans, which have detailed out the roles and structures that have to be implemented at each level, at the national level, the regional level, the district level, and even at facility level. More recently, we have introduced the result-based financing as one of the health financing strategy, and one of the key components in RBF is that the incentives have to be based on quality improvement. So if you are to be compensated or rewarded for any outcomes, there is a big component of assessing what is the quality of your outcomes. And so we look at that one as going to be a very important incentive to drive the culture of quality in this country. We have trained the critical mass in quality improvement, especially with support from our partners, mentoring and coaching. And we have introduced quality improvement assessment tools so that various health facilities are able to assess their performance. Regarding the issue of discussing opportunities for a more macro system approach, as I've already said, ours is a whole system approach and it is not a sort of disease specific. So that one we have already addressed and it's no longer a big problem with us. What are the financial investments we can look at? How do we mobilize more resources from government? One of the first advantages is that our program is based on a quality assurance department, which is a government department like any other department. If you have a health planning department, you have a national disease control department, community health department. So quality assurance department is a department like any other, which gets government of Uganda funding. It has to develop its plan and compete for funds which come into the health sector. If there is an increase of funding to the health sector, certainly the department will get more funding. If there is a decline in funding, certainly there will be less funding, but it gets funding like any other department of the Ministry of Health. And as I've said also, the RBF strategy, looking at the component of quality, will help us get more funding into the health sector. And the Ministry of Finance currently has adopted the result-based financing as a strategy for future funding, especially in the Ministry of Health and in the education sector, where we are looking at mainly the results. But as a health sector, we emphasized that we will not look only at results without looking at quality. Because you may say, I've delivered certain mothers, but you've delivered certain mothers, how many fresh stillbirths did you have? How many septic cesarean sections? So it's not a question of how many the results, but what was the quality of those results? Finally, I will run through the takeaway lessons. If we were to share with our colleagues, what are the lessons we have done, we have got from this implementation of the strategy so far or the program? One of the most important, I would think, is the wholesome system approach. The fact that we are not looking at quality improvement in HIV, quality improvement in malaria, but as an entire health sector approach. And this has even helped us of recent because we have adopted it wholesome when we've been responding to various epidemics in this country, like we recently were responding to the epidemic of Ebola and DRC. We employed the same strategies of quality improvement system. For instance, in the patient flow, in isolation units, we are looking at treatment algorithms. We are looking at data analysis and team approach. So we adopted those basic principles of quality improvement in those responses, especially to Ebola and currently the coronavirus. Another lesson which would be very important, which I think is that the initial partner support is very critical to starting off the program, because much as government may be critical for sustaining it, you need partners to support you to start it and to get government to appreciate the role of quality of care. The commitment of senior top management is important, as I've already mentioned, and also developing a country-specific quality improvement strategy to ensure that it is government-led, not led by partners, and the government helps to harmonize, because sometimes when what you find, different partners may come with different strategies, may come with different understanding of quality of care, but government has to harmonize it and adapt and say, this is the approach we will take and this is what we are going to consider as our strategy in this country. And also very important is knowledge sharing, like the different implementing partners, different projects, different districts can have successful projects. So if you bring them together and they learn from each other, we've been doing that, for instance, from annual quality improvement meetings, conferences, regional QI meetings, our knowledge management portal. One district can learn from the other what it was able to achieve better, and one district can also show what it failed to achieve, and then you can learn from each other. So we also think that is a very good practice. Lastly, we failed really to introduce pre-service training, and we feel that this is something we should have done. Despite the many years we have been implementing this strategy, quality improvement, we have failed to introduce it. What we are having mainly in our training schools is more posts, as in serving strategy, in service training, but we have failed to introduce it as a training curriculum. So that by the time somebody comes from a nursing school or a medical school for doctors and paramedicals, they are already ingrained with a culture of quality. That we have not done much, and we feel it is a gap we need to address. Thank you very much.
Victor, Henry, thank you very much. Wonderful presentation. I'm looking at the time, but there is a comment from John that I would like to read out aloud. And it really summarizes everything we're talking about. Strong leadership and commitment from the Ministry of Health in Uganda has been instrumental. The fact that Dr. Henry Mubwesa, who, for those who may not know, is the Director General of the Ministry of Health, is able to be at this webinar, aware that he is leading the COVID-19 response in Uganda, is clear testimony to his commitment and keen interest in QI that has enabled the country to achieve a lot of institutionalization. I think, Henry, this is huge testimony to the wonderful work you have done over decades, and I definitely echo that. That has been my experience over a couple of decades of working with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rashad. I appreciate the comments.
If I may, I would like to move on to our fourth and last learning topic, and that is the strategic value of improvement in addressing the public health emergencies, a very important topic, especially in these days. Our presenter is Jorge Hermida, and our commentator is Siobhan Bell from the Ministry of Health of Antigua and Barbuda. Jorge, Siobhan, welcome. I'll hand over to you.
Good morning. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Rashad. It's great to be with all of you. Next slide, please. I'm going to reflect briefly about what we learned about the strategic value of QI in addressing public health emergencies when working around the Zika epidemic in Latin America and the Caribbean. And I think these lessons may be of utmost importance in these times that the whole world is struggling with the current pandemic. So there are some realities and some lessons that we learned. The first reality is that we saw that in public health emergencies, the emphasis is on equipment and supplies. But the actual delivery of healthcare is often overlooked. For example, in the Zika epidemic, we saw that there was a lot of emphasis in providing condoms to the healthcare systems when the sexual transmission was discovered. However, even though health centers began to have condoms, our QI teams realized that a lot of women who were given condoms were throwing them in the trash bins after they were given the condoms. So QI teams had to understand the process of actually using a condom in the family and not just putting all the emphasis on the actual input, on the actual supply in this case. That's how we worked with QI teams to understand and improve this process. Our big lessons was that QI methods are able to improve the delivery of care in significant levels at larger scale and in a fast way. That's how around the Zika epidemic, we were able to improve many processes like counseling, diagnosis of microcephaly, managing congenital syndrome complications, psychoemotional support, and others. More than 90% of all women who came to ANC received counseling. Out of those, 95% were able to identify the risk of sexual transmission of the virus. Another reality is that in public health emergencies, the magnitude of issues is huge. But we learned that modern QI methods are able to reach large numbers of facility personnel on sites at the same time when using the appropriate methods, for example, internet-based technology. We were able, in the Zika epidemic, to train more than 18,000 professionals in 13 countries and reach more than 180,000 pregnant women who were counseled and given more than 500,000 condoms, together with the improvement that I just mentioned a moment ago. So QI is able to work at a large scale. Another reality we learned is that the speed of response is of the essence in public health emergencies. But we also learned that QI interventions can be deployed swiftly because most critical materials were already developed and only needed small adaptations. Most countries already had a critical mass of QI-trained professionals who acted as coaches. Most countries already had an existing QI program at national and subnational levels, and QI interventions were integrated into those. And finally, health emergencies are have a serious issue, which is fragmentation of care and lack of coordination of the response. And that's why we learned the importance that QI needs to be integrated as part of the emergency response planning. And now I will invite Dr. Siobhan Bell, who is the head of the pediatrics department at Mount St. John's Medical Center in Antigua, who will offer a perspective of in-country work. Please, Siobhan.
Thank you, Jorge. Greetings, everyone. It's definitely a privilege for me to be here with you today. And it's very clear that any public health system must be able to respond quickly and effectively, and that resilience is key. There's definitely, the framework is very important, and it can be definitely applied to any public health crisis. And so today I'm hoping to translate our response in Antigua and Barbuda to infants and their families potentially affected by Zika to any public health emergency. Definitely the players may be different, but the game remains the same. And so in quality improvement, there are several core concepts that we were able to establish and look at here in Antigua and Barbuda. The first thing was process. We thought we had a very good process, but through the external eyes of USAID ASSIST, our perspective was broadened. We recognized that we did not have a clear process moving from chain of events to outcomes. And so we were able to develop roadmaps, develop algorithms. And now we can say that anyone entering the public health system can easily pick up that there's a defined process. The second core concept is the emphasis on systems. We know that people and information are closely intertwined when it comes to systems, and you actually have to take a multi-sectoral approach. In any system, it can only be effective if you have the right people sitting at the right table at the right time. And so for us, we recognize the importance of integrating the Ministry of Health, the Ministry of Social Transformation, the Ministry of Education, non-governmental organizations in our response to the public health crisis. And so too, even now in the COVID-19 pandemic, we're able to utilize such a similar framework of a multi-sectoral approach to appropriately respond. What about quantifiable measures? Very important. Changes in a system must be monitored, and I must say that this is one of our most treasured experiences working along with USAID ASSIST. The ability to utilize the improvement indicator database was absolutely phenomenal. We were able to track outcomes based on facilities. We were able to utilize our plan, do, study, act cycles. We were able to see changes as they occurred, and these changes, once seen, motivated more change. And so it's definitely important to look at quantifiable measures. Reducing variability. We recognize that in healthcare systems, unnecessary variability does exist. It must be eliminated. And the only way to reduce this is by quality improvement. And so for us, we recognize that moving from community health center to health center, there was significant variability which had to be changed. And we utilized coaches to help to guide this process. Coaching is very key. They basically led the way. They were able to guide the teams. And so now we can see a more standard approach as we move across our healthcare systems. And what is quality improvement without sustainability? Quality improvement must be ongoing. It can't be a one-time initiative. And it really cannot just be related to a single project. Instead, it should be applied across the board. And so we recognize that in Antigua and by extension the Caribbean, sustainability was challenged by limitations of human resource and equipment. We have challenges of competing priorities. We are a region that are often affected by natural disasters. And so solutions that were able to come to the fore included capacity building, use of site visits, use of webinars. We now have built a regional pool that we can tap into. And so even now in the COVID-19 pandemic, we have significant psychosocial support through our psychosocial teams. We're able to call on our neighboring countries to help us in the fight against the coronavirus. And definitely integrating change into our systems, making change the new norm, is something that is key to sustainability. Buy-in is important. Our Minister of Health was able to testify that this project was one of the best that he has seen in a very long time, recognizing that organizational leadership is important as it does drive organizational culture. And so in conclusion, quality improvement is actually very critical to response to any public health emergency. It is very key to close the gap between what is actual and what is ideal. The public health response is too important of a concept for any nation to be satisfied with just operating on the norm. We are definitely interested in quality improvement, and although there are barriers, they will be overcome. If we utilize the appropriate staff, leadership, and policymakers, quality improvement will not only be here for one project, but it will be sustained. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jorge. Thank you, Siobhan. Wonderful presentation. I have a question for one question for each of you. Others, please type in questions. And as I said, if we get to them now, we do. And if we don't, we will address them later on. Siobhan, I have a question for you that I've held off asking earlier. It comes from Alison Lucas, and her question is the following. Have the facilities that have instituted improvement and have the teams that have worked in improvement been better able to deal with the COVID epidemic? And I know that you are dealing with this right now and you've had that experience, and I thought maybe you could answer that question.
So definitely our response has been able to have a better impact because of our previous guidance in response to the Zika challenge. We do recognize the importance of utilizing a team approach. And as we said, we're able to tap into regional partners to appropriately respond to varied challenges. We, in the teams within the health centers, they have had a basically problem-solving approach. And so now, as we go out, for example, in contact tracing, we're able to say, okay, what is it that we're doing? How many persons have we contacted? What is it that we can do differently? So we're instituting things like the five whys, you know, the fishbone diagram, things that will guide us to make a significant change or adapt as we go along. And so the whole issue of quality improvement, as I said before, cannot be limited to Zika. We have utilized similar strategies in our response to COVID-19.
Thank you very much. Jorge, this is a question from Tarub to you. She says, thank you, Jorge, for sharing such amazing results. Can you elaborate on gender integration in the context of emergency response and how it was addressed, especially in the hard to reach areas?
Thanks to the important work of the YHER, of YHER as a partner in the ASSIST project, the project was able to initially create conscience, awareness among healthcare workers and authorities of the importance of the gender approach in this epidemic. I can say that initially, most of the emphasis was put on the mother as the only person who was responsible to take action to prevent the transmission of Zika, forgetting the role of the male partner and other gender aspects. So creating awareness was very important, and this was done in many countries, as I said, with a very important action of WHIHER. But then supporting health workers to actually implement actions to integrate the partners and in more in general, gender approach in all work. For example, in counseling, in antenatal care, bringing the male partner to counseling sessions and other actions like that. So it was an ongoing activity with the knowledge that gender is of extreme importance in this work.
Thank you, Jorge. Thank you, Siobhan. At this point, what I'd like to do is to thank our speakers, our commentators. I also want to thank our participants for your comments and for your questions and engagement with the topic. Our speakers, commentators really made this a very lively section, and I very much appreciate that. With this, if I may now move to the next section in the meeting, which is the facilitated discussion and questions and answers from the participants. We have three amazing discussants with us who have been heavily engaged and contributed to shaping the ASSIST project as we know it. Our discussants are Tim Quick from USAID Office of HIV and AIDS, Troy Jacobs from the USAID Maternal and Neonatal and Child Health Team, and Shem Said from the World Health Organization. What we have done is to give each one of them a question and ask them to reflect on it and share their reflections with us. So if I may first go to Tim, please. Tim, the question we had for you was, what takeaways do you have from the cross-country learning activities of the Partnership for HIV-Free Survival that USAID can apply going forward? Please, Tim.
Thanks, Rashad. Greetings all. Just to frame my comments a bit, the Partnership for HIV-Free Survival was galvanized and led by PEPFAR with WHO and UNICEF. It was a six-country initiative in Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, Mozambique, Lesotho, and South Africa. It focused on the application of QI to establish a PMTCT continuum of care, beginning in the antenatal period and then extending out to 18 to 24 months postpartum. And we wanted to get mothers tested, on treatment, adherent, virally suppressed, bringing mothers and baby pairs together for each of their visits in the postnatal period, providing them all child survival and infant young child feeding support. It prioritized shared learning across sites and across countries, and really emphasized the need to spread QI. The launch meeting was in 2013, and we had two regional meetings in Eastern and Southern Africa, but I really want to focus on two cross-country knowledge exchange meetings that we had for peer-to-peer learning. Each was 3 to 5 days. Lesotho went to Uganda, Kenya went to Tanzania. In the weeks preceding those meetings, the teams met together, the representatives from the Ministry of Health with the people who led the QI effort from ASSIST and implementing partners, and over the weeks preceding those meetings, they met to review their progress, to reflect, to synthesize all their learning and to take that to the meeting. So it really was instrumental in bringing those Partnership for HIV for Survival teams together even before they went to visit the country. When they got to the country, there was an initial plenary meeting and breakout sessions, but the key part of the visits were going out to clinic sites and together those teams looking at what was being done, sharing what they were doing respectively in each of their countries, seeing the quality improvement in practice. So then they came back. They came back together and reflected on what they had learned, and then had time in the meeting to consider how they could apply it going forward. So the focus was not just on the specifics of PMTCT service delivery, but it was how to better apply the quality improvement to all of their work. So I think the three key takeaways for me in how these worked was there was an emphasis on the quality improvement is data driven. They need to achieve evidence-based improvements through iterative testing of changes in service delivery. The QI is team driven. There's a need to enhance quality improvement capacity and application to all of their systems and service. So those teams really come together at each level to learn from what they're doing and to apply that to how they can make those improvements. And finally, quality improvement is shared learning driven. There is a need to learn within the sites to then share that across sites within a country. And then we really felt that there were great benefits in those cross-country meetings for those teams to share what they had learned and learn from one another. So I would just say quality improvement has been a real revelation for me, and it's something that I feel is critical to all of our implementation and service delivery work. I've become a very fervent advocate and disciple of QI. So it's been a real privilege for me to work with ASSIST and to learn from the program. So Rashad, thank you.
Tim, thank you very much. For us, it's been a real privilege to have your insights, to have your program design and the efforts that you have launched and the results achieved as a result of that. Thank you very much. If I may now go to our next discussant, we have Troy Jacobs from the USAID Maternal, Neonatal and Child Health Team. Troy, we asked Troy the following question. We said, what do you see as the value of improvement in addressing critical maternal, neonatal, child health problems going forward? Troy, please.
Rashad and others, can you hear me?
We hear you well, and we see
beautiful,
you. Thank you
beautiful.
Very much.
One thing, first of all, I just want to clarify that I am actually part of the Office of Maternal Child Health and Nutrition. And there are actually a number of colleagues that are interested in the issue of quality of care, of quality improvement. And I sit in that office with my colleagues. And so I want to thank the presenters that I come after, because in some ways it makes the question, Rashad, that you're posing a bit easier for me. They were very interesting and rich presentations. And what I'm going to do is echo some of the things that have been said over the last hour and a half or so. The first thing is that there is incredible interest in quality improvement at USAID. Within our office, across offices, headquarters, field, in the countries, this is all comes out in the presentations and our discussion. When we think about what is critical MCH problems, this is an interesting issue because a lot of our colleagues have thought in terms of what we would maybe frame as effective coverage, that there is a need, a gap, and we will fill that need and scale up and think about use. And we've evolved to a point where we've been thinking more and more about the impact of quality on that coverage or scale up or use. And that's really very critical. And that's going to continue going forward. We know that in order to be effective, we've got to improve quality for impact. And it's also, it can be costly in terms of mortality or suffering or resources used. The second issue, which came up earlier, is that we are seeing new problems. Those could be new innovations. It could be a series of, outbreaks that we're dealing with, whether it was H1N1 a long time ago, Ebola, Zika, now COVID. I don't know what it would be in the future, but it does flag a need for having MCH QI competencies, things around sort of systems-based practice, the problem solving that we've talked about, adaptive learning, teamwork. These are all very critical as we go forward so that we can encounter these problems and solve them in a meaningful way. The third piece in terms of our interest in quality improvement that I cannot miss is that it is not just about provision of services. The demand issues are really quite critical for us in MCH. And whether this is framed as experience of care or other demand issues, they are critical and they are acknowledgedly harder to deal with maybe than some of the provision issues. The problem that we have is we've got to balance the sustained work and the interest that we have in these various areas with the new areas, because this is part of a more complicated MCH menu. And this is where I think QI has a critical role in helping us to be able to do this balancing. ASSIST has shown that the QI methods and approaches can be understandable, doable, relevant in low and middle income countries. But at the same time, what they have done has improved the methods that we use in quality improvement. And this is very important for MCH. The settings that we work in MCH are critical as well. A lot of the focus with QI tends to be on facilities and particularly more advanced facilities like hospitals. This is a very good place to start because there's lots of data or more data there. But it is limiting in some ways for what we want to think about in MCH. The critical issues extend beyond that to more basic facilities in the communities. And we know that there's more work that needs to be done in that space. And so I'll finish up. All of us are on a QI journey, okay? Whether we are driving in a motor vehicle or walking, that is variable. And so these questions and issues that came up around the depth of capacity, the competency to do QI, is very relevant in the MCH space. We see many times where there is not deep understanding, but it is actually a mechanistic, a superficial use of quality improvement. And if we are going to be able to address MCH problems, critical problems, we've got to go to a deeper understanding from national level all the way down to community. And I'll leave it at that. I hope everyone stays safe and healthy as we all move along our QI journeys. And I know we can do this. We've seen that we can. And I'll turn it over to Rashad.
Troy, as always, wonderful words. Thank you very much. Very insightful. I would like now to introduce our third and last discussant, a good colleague and friend from the World Health Organization, partner with us on this journey, Shams Sayed. The question that we asked Shams was the following: where do we as a global community need to go from here to continue to build sustainable capacity for QI within country health systems in support of universal health coverage and the SDGs? Shams, if I may turn over to you, please.
Thank you, Rashad, and greetings everybody. I know that time is short, but I'd just like to just say how much I enjoyed listening to the entire proceedings, such rich perspectives, and I'm sure that this could have been a whole day, but really congratulations to everybody that's been involved in that work. So in reflecting in this on this question, I really would like to be focused on three areas. So the first area is related to something that's been mentioned a number of times during this capstone, and that's the focus on national efforts and national strategic direction setting on quality. That's particularly important in relationship to the sustainability that's been mentioned over and over again. And also in recognition that QI is a never-ending journey, and that can be somewhat frustrating for many, but of course it's the reality that we face in health services. And also, and it was mentioned by colleagues today, it allows a nation to own and drive sustainable and optimized healthcare, and it allows interventions to be intentionally decided upon and implemented at all levels of the health system. The other aspect of a national direction is the necessity to have a measurement framework that speaks to the strategy that's been decided by a country, and actually touches on evolving measurement approaches, particularly, and Troy just mentioned it, particularly related to effective coverage and how that will pan out in the next decade. The other really important piece within this national strategic direction, it allows maximal synergy between disease programs, between population-focused programs, and a wider systems approach. And that's particularly why I wanted to place emphasis on that point. And that's the first point. The second one, in the next phase of our work, we really do need to support each other and countries in ensuring strong linkages between the QI world and the primary healthcare approach. And I know that many of you would have been involved in all of the work related to Astana and everything that emerged from that, but it does allow us to bring in the three dimensions related to primary healthcare approach: the primary care and essential public health functions, so bringing in the public health dimension. The second being engagement and empowerment of communities, again, hugely important. And the third, multisectorality and the multisectoral approach. So all of these pieces need to be considered for QI to have its maximal effect on national health systems moving forward. The third point or area that I'd like to just touch on is the critical importance of capacity building for QI in a system that's going to be tackling emergencies. And it's very beautifully described earlier on in the capstone, but just wanted to make two points of emphasis. One is the maintenance of essential health services during an emergency, and how QI can be applied to ensure that, one, the services are maintained, but secondly, that the quality of those services there is attention to the quality of those services. And that can be a gap that can be directly filled with a focus on quality. And then the second piece, which is even more of troubling in some ways, is the populations that are affected by fragility, conflict, and vulnerability. So with our drive towards universal health coverage and the sustainable development goals, we do need an intentional focus on quality improvement capacity in some of the most difficult places on the planet. Sadly, billions of our fellow human beings are affected by this. So it is something that can be brought to bear on the equation around health by the quality improvement community. So thank you, Rashad. Thank you, colleagues. And I've thoroughly enjoyed listening to you all.
Shams, wonderful words. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. We are almost at time, but I do not see questions directed to our three discussants. However, if you have a question, you can type it in now. But there is a response from Henry, which to the earlier question on improvement, and has it helped with the COVID response? And if I can just read part of that in the meantime. Henry says, so far only four hospitals have admitted positive cases and have used QI concepts and principles for case management. Real-time data has also been used for surveillance. Teamwork has been key, and systems approach for logistics management, PPE, and lab supplies. Communication, community awareness, risk communication has been a major preventive intervention. I think that summarizes the use of improvement in a beautiful way. Thank you, Henry, for that response. With that,
thank you, Rashad. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm looking, I do not see any other questions. Let me then, first of all, thank our three discussants, Tim, Troy, and Chems, for your wonderful reflections and very insightful comments. And at this point, what I'd like to do is to make a beautiful announcement. If I can ask my colleague Lani to take this from here.
Thank you, Rashad. We are very excited to announce the upcoming publication of the online book, Improving Healthcare in Low and Middle Income Countries Casebook. And this book is a collection of 12 in-depth case studies that describe in detail and are written by health professionals how they applied QI methods to a particular problem area, what results they achieved, and they reflect on the lessons that they learned in doing this. This book is intended to help both program implementers as well as students to understand what quality improvement looks like in practice. As you can see on the slide, the cases draw from 11 different countries, and they draw on work supported by both USAID as well as HRSA and the Farm Access Foundation in the Netherlands. I should say that this book was inspired by the work of Jim Hybe. He started this book project several years ago, and we're really grateful for his leadership in making this happen. We'll be holding another webinar in early June to promote when the online book is available, and we will be sending out invitations to everyone to join that. It'll be a great discussion.
Thank you, Lani, and please stay tuned for the next invite from the ASSIST project for the book launch. This brings us to the end of our program today, and I would like to ask Kelly Saldana to give us the director of the Office of Health Systems at USAID to give us closing remarks on behalf of the agency. Kelly, please.
Thank you, Rashad. This has been a great webinar. And before I start, I just want to acknowledge the Herculean effort that I think both you and Kelsey have been doing in managing the overall webinar in a quite seamless way, responding to comments and questions and dealing with unexpected intruders. So I think just kudos to you all, because I'm sure it's been a lot of work behind the scenes. So I've been at USAID for 17 years myself, and I think have had some involvement in the ASSIST and its predecessor projects since I started at that time. And I think over the course of that time, you forget how much this project and this series of work has really influenced the overall agenda. So I really appreciated listening to all the learning sessions today and all the different presentations. As we were going through, I was just reflecting myself on sort of where I think we are going in the field of health systems, and how I really do think that there's a lot of roots in everything that has been done through the series of projects and through the quality improvement approaches. And so just a couple of the things that I noted that I think are part of the conversation today, which I think find a root and a home in the work of the ASSIST project and hopefully can be then used to move on that in the way forward. I think there's a growing conversation around better integration of data and data sources and better use of data in the health system. And I think if you look to quality improvement, you can see that, you know, there's really a revolution of the field in terms of looking at lots of different data sources and bringing them together to understand something about how care is happening, what is missing, and refining data over time. I'm also struck by the way that quality improvement approaches and methodologies really look to different sources and different ways to learn, to constantly be evaluating. And I think that there's some clear parallels to that with what we currently talk about, you know, in health systems in a more global sense, is really understanding the impact of health systems interventions on system-wide effects and looking to different methodologies and sources of data to really understand what I think for health systems is still a relatively new field. So I was impressed by the, you know, Jim Hybe's reflections that he was most proud of the fact that you really invented the field as you went along. And I think there's some work to be done in health systems on that as well. I think the other thing is there's an evolving conversation about sort of integration across different aspects of health systems. And I think some new efforts to build financing into quality of care through results-based financing and value-based care methodologies, which I really think add a dimension to quality improvement work, but must be grounded in overall quality improvement to have any sort of hope of being successful. And then thinking about how we can scale those up through both the public health system as well as within individual sort of franchisee and private sector health systems. I think within USAID, we talk a lot about the journey to self-reliance and transitioning to local partners. And I'm just so impressed by all the work that ASSIST has done, as evidenced by, you know, all of the great speakers and participants who can reflect on their individual country experiences. And so I think we're really ahead of the time in how to really build that local capacity and really transfer ownership to the local level that I think USAID can learn a lot about throughout the course of our projects. I think the last two sort of themes that I noted that I think come from the ASSIST project or have the roots in the ASSIST project is I think within health systems, there's an evolving conversation with the Lancet Commission report published last year about thinking about the design of healthcare systems and the overall structure of care. And I think, as you've rightly pointed out, there's the structure of care, and then there's also the process of care. And really, we need to think about both and where there's opportunities to refine structures to perhaps address some of those three levels of the primary healthcare push that Shams talked about, but also then to make sure that when we think about process and structure, or when we think about structure, we're not forgetting about process, and that we really are marrying those two things together. And so I think the ASSIST project has really contributed to that. And then last but not least, within the Office of Health Systems, we're really trying to encourage people to focus on the outcomes that we're trying to achieve and to build interventions around achieving specific outcomes. And I think that is very clearly rooted in this quality improvement work, because although the way to do that focuses on the process, it is always about improving outcomes and improving the experience of care and the quality of care. And I think the more people can recognize that and remember sort of the end goal and improve quality from that, I think that lends lessons to both quality and improving care, but also to improving health systems as a whole. So I think just on behalf of the Office of Health Systems and USAID, we look forward to building on all of these themes and are just grateful for all of the work that has been done over the years through the ASSIST project. And largely conceived of and led by Jim Hybe. It was so nice to see him this morning. And just congratulations to all of you. And we really look forward to seeing you in a month or so on the webinar related to the casebook. Thank you.
Thank you, Kelly. Well, with this, if I can say a few last words before we conclude. I have to start by saying that it's really a humbling experience to be at the helm of a global mechanism like ASSIST and its predecessors. I'm very proud of the results achieved, the global cadre of improvers that have been created, the health systems that have been impacted, the learning that has been generated, and the relationships that have been nurtured in all of the above. I have a number of people to thank, and I want to start with USAID, first of all, for giving us the opportunity and the privilege to do this work. I want to thank our AOR team in particular, Lisa, Ria, Porna, and also all of our USAID colleagues with whom we've had the pleasure to work both in DC and in the countries. I want to thank the health providers in the countries without whom this could have never been done. I also want to thank the patients who have been critical members of improvement teams in all the 46 countries where we have worked. I want to thank their supervisors, the thought leaders in the country. I want to thank the governments without whom this could have never been done in all of the countries where we worked. I especially want to thank our staff, the ASSIST staff in the countries as well as in headquarters, who have worked tirelessly and have really evolved this work into what it is. I especially want to thank our partners, multiple partners, organizations, and individuals who have really been critical to enriching this work. I want to extend my thank you to the whole global community of improvers that we belong to. In doing this work, it wasn't just about the project and its partners. We reached way beyond that, and we did work with the whole community of improvers. On a personal level, I would like to thank all of my colleagues and friends from whom I have learned so much in doing this work and have had the pleasure of working with. I want to particularly thank my mentor, Don Berwick. I want to thank my predecessor, Dave Nicholas, and I want to thank Jim Hybe again for giving me this opportunity, for trusting me, and for many years of support in doing this work. I would like to thank our speakers, commentators, discussants for the meeting today. I would like to thank all of our participants for your wonderful insights and for joining us today. With this, I declare the meeting adjourned. Thank you all very much.